Welcome. We'll start with the second chapter for class 10th history, and in this chapter we would focus on the Indochina and the various independence movements that started in Indochina. Now if you look onto the map of Indochina, we would have, this is the map that was during the French period, and this is the present day map. On the present day map, you can see you have Laos, Cambodia and Vietnam. Together these three countries form the Indochina. However, during French time or during the French occupation in Vietnam, this Vietnam was divided into three regions. It was Tonkin, Annam and Cochin China. The Cochin China was the southernmost part of the Vietnam. During the French-Chinese war, the region of Tonkin and Annam was captured from China by French, and this was one of the major victories that France witnessed in Vietnam, or basically in the Indochina region. So the history of Indochina region becomes very, very interesting and important to understand, because there has been a constant conflict between the Chinese interest as well as the French interest during that time. So let's start with some of the basic concepts here. So as we know, the Vietnam basically gained its independence in 1945, but even after that it took nearly three decades for France to become a kind of republic. So the developments we have traced for the region so far, the northern and the central portion, as we said, was captured from China by France, and that was the region of Tonkin and Annam. And the hinterlands of those regions lying close to the region of Cambodia were occupied by Khmer Cambodians, and those were the natives who lived there. So these were the important features that we try to understand. Now why France was interested in Vietnam and why France was looking to develop and build colonies? Some of the predominant reasons were, first, these regions had ample supply of natural resources. Second, France was looking for an idea that if they are able to colonize the people or civilize basically the people in this region, they would have more market and they could earn more business and more profit. So it was basically a business driven, profit driven motive, what we can say. The next was, to increase all this, they were looking for constant developments in the region. Developments were in the form of building up of canals for irrigation purposes, because this was a kind of very fertile belt with rice as a predominant cultivation that could be seen there. Vietnam was the third largest exporter of rice during that time in the world. It was also looking for increasing the production of agriculture that could be exported, and these export to the international market could bring in revenue for France. So considering all these facts, France was trying to build a kind of railway network within the Indochina region, and that could connect the South and the North Vietnam. And finally, this was completed with a link with Yunnan province of China in 1910. A second link was made with Siam via the Phnom Penh, that's the capital of Cambodia. So those two links were the extension of the Trans-Indochina rail network that was started. The next were, there were various writers and policymakers who believed that the economies of these colonies need to be developed, and the cause we have already stated, it was basically to bring in more market opportunities, develop business and bring in profit. But Vietnam during that time was suffering from three major issues. One was a very high burden of population. Second was the lack of education or a very low rate of literacy. Only the Vietnamese elite were given education. In 1925, of the 17 million people, only 400 could clear the school leaving examination. So you can understand the fraction of the people that were educated in Vietnam during that time. The third reason was, so far the region has been witnessing low agricultural productivity. So these three were the major issues that France had to look forward for bringing in development into Vietnam. The second was the plantation crops. Now plantation crops here included rice and rubber, predominantly owned by France and a small proportion of Vietnamese elite. Now this Vietnamese elite had a preset Chinese culture in mind, and that was again a conflict for France. So considering this, education was a big challenge. Now, France on one side was looking to educate the people. However, on the other side, it was afraid that if the people are educated, they would raise a voice against the people of France. So that they were not ready to tolerate. So they were trying to bring in education to educate people, but they were again trying to limit the resources so that a limited section could get access to education. Again, French was being introduced as a medium of instruction. So lower standard had Vietnamese, a higher standard has French as a language. When this French was introduced as a language, they were considering the fact that they could create an Asiatic France in a region outside France. So within Asia, they were trying to create a culture that was unique to France in the Indochina region. Again, they were basically fearing that if the Vietnamese people are educated, the jobs that were owned by the French people there could be lost by the Vietnamese, because since Vietnamese would be educated, they would go in for the local jobs and the French people might lose their job. So that was again a conflict to provide education to the people of Vietnam. So the emphasis was on the languages that were being taught. So as we said, lower classes had Vietnamese, higher classes has French. But again, the teachers who were teaching were initially teaching French as it was, but slowly and gradually, even besides the prescribed syllabus they had, they started criticizing the French. So there was a revolution or kind of rebellion that grew in the mind of the local students that were lying there. So textbooks were glorifying French, but the Vietnamese teachers who were teaching there, who were taking courses on those topics, were slowly and gradually inculcating the feeling of criticism of French within the students. As a result, you had numerous developments that took place. So one of the examples was the Tonkin Free School that started in 1907. It was providing Western style of education. This Western style included science, hygiene, and French. And they were promoting the adaptation of not only sciences, but a westernization in the outfit. So they were looking forward for short haircut. And traditionally, Vietnamese had long hairs. So that was again a conflict with the culture that was witnessed during that time. So students were asked to sit on the back rows who were Vietnamese, and the French students were asked to come forward within the classroom setting. So this created protest within the setup. Now similarly, we can trace an example for the untouchables or the Dalits in India, where B.R. Ambedkar took the revolution. So when you are trying to study any concept, try to relate it across the globe. So more or less the developments that were witnessed in one part of the world, you would witness similar developments in other part of the world. So those were the developments that led to revolution within the students. As a result, there were numerous political parties founded. Some of the parties were party of Young Anan, and there were journals that were published in the name of Anani's students. So those were the developments that took place within the student. Now some of the students were looking forward to work against colonialism. So they started a Go East movement. Under the Go East movement, students were moving to Japan and looking forward, because Japan had a victory over Russia, and they were feeling that if we are looking forward to Japan, we could bring in or we could replicate those things within our own nation. So those were the kind of feelings that were coming within the people or the common man. Now here we have the timeline, how the things started in 1820, and there was creation of Indochina that we had already seen. Now Ho Chi Minh was one of the major leaders who led forward for the independence of Vietnam and basically unification of Vietnam later on. So his party was known as the Vietnamese Communist Party. Now if you look onto the map of Vietnam, the North Vietnam was under the Ho Chi Minh, and the South Vietnam was under Bao Dai, and Bao Dai was a kind of puppet ruler under the French government. So later on, replacing Bao Dai, here came Daim, and he was a very repressive and autocratic ruler. So those developments later on led to the idea of strong unification and development of NLF, that's National Liberation Front. And finally, you had the unification of Vietnam that took place. So those are the important timelines that we have mentioned here. As we go across the lesson, we would have more here. Now, a very interesting example was the hygiene, disease and resistance. So what happened was there was an outbreak of plague. Now, as we know, plague is spread by rats, and the most important location that was affected was Hanoi. In Hanoi, so far the situation was, the region was divided into two halves. One where the French people lived and other where the local Vietnamese people lived. Now the French people, where they lived, this region was nicely developed, having roads, infrastructure, good sewer line. But the region of where the local Vietnamese people were living did not have ample facilities. Because of the outbreak of plague, rats went into the sewer lines. Now these sewer lines were opening into French homes. So these French homes were being attacked by rats. What the people ordered, or the French government ordered during that time, was a bounty program. Now under bounty program, they started with the rat hunt. What happened in the rat hunt? In the rat hunt, they said that the local Vietnamese who are meant to do these kinds of jobs should capture the rats and bring it to the government. If the government sees that they have captured a rat, they would give them some monetary or some kind of reward in that. So this later on changed, and the government said, okay, bring in the tail of the rat. So you had to cut simply the tail of the rat and bring it in front of the government. Now you would be given money in lieu of that. But later on, what happened, people became smart. They started to bring the tail of the rat every time. So every time they used to bring in another tail and another tail. So like that, people started to put rats in their home, or put rats as pets in their homes. So this bounty program was later on felt that there was a big issue with this rat population and the bounty program going on. So this program was later on scrapped. When it comes to religious belief, Vietnam is a land of mixed cultures. You have Buddhism, Confucianism, and the various local practices that were prevalent during that time. French, when they came, they brought along with them Christianity. Now this Christianity had a kind of intolerance towards the easygoing attitude of the common people living there. So there was a scholars' revolt in 1868, and this scholars' revolt was against the Catholics and the French power. So now the things changed to religion as well. So religious conversions or religious issues came into being, and 3 lakh people were converted by Catholic missionaries during that time. There were uprisings in 2 common provinces, that was Ong An and Ha Tinh province, and lots of Catholics were killed in that region. Similarly, you have the Hau Hau movement in 1939 in Mekong Delta. Now, this is again a very interesting movement. The leader or the founder of this movement was Phu So, and Phu So basically was known to perform miracles. So he had an idea, people should not consume alcohol, should not consume opium, people should not go for gambling or child brides. And finally, what happened was, French government declared that he was mentally sick and he should go to a mental asylum. When the doctors checked on him, the doctors were asked or forced to prove that he was a mentally ill person and there should not be so many followers of him. However, during his stay in the mental asylum, he converted the philosophy of doctors as well. So not only the Vietnamese doctor in that region, but even the French doctors of that time started to believe that he was a sane person. So authorities finally exiled him to Laos and all his followers to the concentration camp. Now when we talk about vision for modernization, there were 2 different views. One view was to go for the developments that are taking place in France and adopt those. So the second was to raise your voice against the French occupation in Indochina. So two specific examples were Phan Boi Chau. He was a revolutionary, he formed the Revolutionary Society, and he wrote a book, The History of the Loss of Vietnam. He basically talked about loss of sovereignty and the severity of the ties with China. So he was against the French occupation and the French domination. The other reformer was Pha Chu Trinh, and he basically talked about that we should inculcate the French ideas, and when we are inculcating the French ideas, we are talking about democratic republic, and we should not only basically he tried to demand a more legal and educational setup that could be driven from French scholars and develop agriculture and industries. So Go East movement, we have already talked about how things were worked under that. And the next important was 1911, there was Sun Yat-sen monarchy that was seen in China, and this monarchy was overthrown and a republic was established in China. Now Vietnamese students during that time organized an association for restoration of Vietnam, and the objective of this association changed from a kind of constitutional monarchy to a democratic republic. So the idea was now democratic republic that should be attained. So communist movement started in Vietnam following Great Depression in 1930. So what happened during Great Depression was the prices of agriculture shot up. As the prices shot up, people were facing hard time because there was lots and lots of rural debt, a huge unemployment that was seen, and rural uprisings that were seen in two provinces, which were basically the Nghệ An and Hà Tĩnh, and these were called as the electric fuses because these were the first provinces to be affected when any pressure builds up in that region. Finally, Ho Chi Minh brought together the nationalist group to establish the Vietnamese Communist Party. And this Communist Party was later renamed as the Indo-China Communist Party. So this was inspired by the military demonstrations that were seen in the Europe Communist Parties. And again, the occupation, the Japan's occupation on Vietnam was a part of the drive to control the Southeast Asia. So those two things were the leading ideas. As a result, you had Viet Minh that was formed. Now this was the League of Independence of Vietnam that was formed, and this fought for the Japanese occupation and recapturing of the Hanoi, which lied in the Tonkin province during that time, which we saw was the northern Vietnam, which lied in the region of northern Vietnam. And finally, Ho Chi Minh became the chairman of it. So the idea was to build a new republic. So Bao Dai, as we said, was a puppet emperor by French rulers, and Vietnam was forced to retreat. 8 years later, you had the France that was defeated, and then Binh Phu was brought to throne in this region. So we have the whole thing how this happened, and Ho Chi Minh came into power in the north and Bao Dai in the south, as we discussed. And finally, this was overthrown by Diem, who was an autocratic ruler, and you have the National Liberation Front that fought for unification. Now during this time, US was fearing that if the North and the South Vietnam gets united, it could be a threat to United States because of the communism that was developing. And when we talk about communism, there was another thing that was domino status. Domino status means a region, if is following a communist philosophy or any other specific philosophy, that region would affect its nearby province. So the idea of communism could spread, and this spread was witnessed as a threat for United States. So United States was very afraid that the idea of communism could spread from Indochina to the neighboring regions. As a result, US entered war from 1965 to 72. More than 3 million US personnel were killed who were serving, basically 3 million, US personnel were serving in Vietnam. Despite of the good medical facilities that were given to them, there was high amount of casualties that were reported from US. The troops arrived with heavy weapons and bombers of the B-52S. There were chemical weapons like napalm, which was a compound used with gasoline for fire bombs, Agent Orange and phosphorus bombs, those were seen. But slowly and gradually, US media criticized war. So because there were the common people who were sent from US into war in that region, and so the US media started to criticize war. Media or movies during that time were playing an important role. So there were certain movies which were favoring wars, the others which were totally against the wars. So some of the examples are here. So you had Greenbelt's film that was motivating men to die for war. On the other hand, you have the Apocalypse that was talking about the moral confusion that the war has caused in US. So Min, as we said, the Ho Chi Minh was one of the active leaders who was working for the independence of Vietnam and its unification. So he took the name Ho Chi Minh in 1943 when he returned back from Europe and Thailand, and he was trying to adopt the communist philosophy that was popular in the European nations during that time. However, he died in 1969 before the things could come. But he established a unique thing that was Ho Chi Minh Trail. Now this trail was very important because this trail was covering north to south Vietnam and was a kind of very unifying force. However, most of the trail lied outside Vietnam in the regions of Laos and Cambodia. But this trail was carrying people. A common man could carry around 25 kgs on his back. With bicycles, they were able to carry 70 kilos a day, and that was the kind of energy they were putting in. They were supporting the people with the base camps, hospitals, all through the trail, and people were joining. So nearly 20,000 North Vietnamese troops came to South Vietnam every month. So there was a huge amount of rebuilding efforts that were taken place with the help of this Ho Chi Minh Trail. And whenever there was a small destruction on this trail, it was immediately repaired by the people there. So with this, you have the major ideas that led to unification. However, not only this, women at that time played a crucial role in unification, or basically independence of Vietnam. So they were brave, they were looking for developments. There was one woman who fought a jet with 20 bullets at a go, and those were the kinds of things that were coming up. There were cases where woman was leaving for a forced marriage to marry someone of her choice, and this was the idea to bring in freedom, bring in the end of the domination of French and Chinese culture there, and a kind of independence that could be seen. So the sisters were idealized and glorified. You have various examples that were seen. You have Tara Au. She was orphanaged in childhood. She left home, went to the jungle and organized a big army, resisted the Chinese invasion in the territory, and ultimately she drowned herself and became a sacred figure later on. So those were the examples that we have witnessed. US-Vietnam War was very, very important because this was considered as the first television war which was shown on a daily basis in the news every day. Again, various scholars, one of the very famous scholars was Chomsky. He said, "The war is the greatest threat to peace, to self-determination of a nation and the national cooperation." So peace settlements were finally signed off in Paris in 1974, and this ended the conflict between US and the fighting between the Saigon regime and the NLF, that's the National Liberation Front, ultimately continued. So finally, National Liberation Front occupied the Saigon Palace in 1975, and a unified Vietnam was finally declared. So with this, we cover the second chapter for class 10. We'll be covering further lectures in the upcoming classes. Do subscribe to our channel. If you have any doubts, you can leave those as comment below the video. We'll be more than happy to resolve those. Have a very good day ahead.